So you remember Hamish from the last video, the guy with the yachts and that beautiful carving at Picton? He's coming down to see a local bluff man down here, who I told him about when I was up in Picton, a chap called Stoney. And Stoney's this lovely man who has got an ongoing project that he's been working on a very long time, and he's put every ounce of energy and every ounce of money into it that he could. And he's gotten to a point where it needs a burst of new life to keep the project going, and the project is a Polynesian double-hulled waka. I don't really know much about Polynesian wakas, but I get the feeling that I'm going to find out.
Greetings, 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 all persons, and welcome to the inside of the Bluff Embassy. I'm here to introduce myself and a project which my wife and I started, my darling wife Megan, started in 1993 with the intention of being finished in 3 years and using it to educate children on the ocean. However, we'll get onto that as we get into the project. I'm Kevin Noel Burke. The boat people know me as Stoney Bourke, and most of Bluff does also, which ties back to a rodeo rider on a television program in New Zealand in the 1960s. Stoney Bourke, they followed him around the rodeos. And with the surname Bourke, I got labelled Stoney. I already had a imitation six gun and a cowboy hat back when I was 15 years old. The project is James Wharrem, Pahi 63. James came up, or Arnica, and James came up with the design quite a few years ago. There have been a few built. It sleeps up to 16 people. And ideally it'd be six or eight adults and the rest children. There's a fire pit in the middle of the deck. It's a very safe boat.
This is Hamish here that we met in the last video up in Picton. He's come all the way down to have a look at the waka as well. So let's go see what we've got.
Nākoe to waka, e mihi nei, e mihi aroha. E mihi nei, e mihi aroha. E mihi nei. We give thanks, we give love. We give thanks, we give love, we give praise.
Big enough for you, Hamish?
That'd be lovely, wouldn't it? These are deck cabins. A couple can stay in them, hop in and sit down. They're mounted across the boat, and the mast sits down on top of this wall with the base down in there. So the wall of the cabin supports the mast, plus you pull your rigging.
What happens here?
That's where the rudder goes. You can lift your rudder to board at sea. It's hanging on a sea anchor being slammed backwards. Rudder damage in yachts is very real.
So you can lift them up, lift the rudder down, they're underneath there and they can turn.
They sit underneath there and turn. They're just down here. Well, again, it sits on the spur.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Only goes as deep as the centre.
As the skig, yeah.
Centre of the boat, which is 3 feet loaded, 2 feet light. And these are built like bamboo, they're hollow. Kauri, tantalised kauri mediums, LOSP treated, which is treated with petrol. They put the tanning in so they don't change colour, they don't go green or pink, and you can still glue it. And they're hollow, this is bamboo. Every 6 feet there's a piece like bamboo in the centre, a piece of this actually. Short piece of this down inside with a piece of ply on it. Cut pieces off that end of this before you put this in there. And you make 6 bamboo segments down inside. You imagine the amount of glue to put on all of these pieces, get it all glued in the same day, because it's all got to be done.
Yeah, all together in one hit.
All in one hit. I had 12 people helping me when I built these.
Yeah, big day.
Oh shoot, did we mix some bloody glue that day? And see this spike here? This has got a copper cable all the way to the other end and out, and that's for redirecting lightning into the water. We've got more stories on that, because a round copper ball on here deflects lightning. I found that out, but I still had to do this for the survey.
Unreal. 6 foot wide all together.
Labour of love, man. And the love of
what a beautiful sailing vessel.
So at the centre are shower toilets in this one, and then the other one would be cooking and dining area. Ideally people can dine in their own cabin, make their room. And this is where your rope lashings go. The crossbeam comes out here and the rope lashing goes around and around and around and then gets pulled tight in the middle. That's why this is all strengthened. Yeah. Yes. There'll be, it's one of the few places there'll be fastenings. There'll be big copper bolts through there and there.
Right.
Because that's the most stretch, that's where the crossbeams fasten.
Wow, I've got to get it on the water, eh? No good in the shed.
Well, it's pretty good in the shed even.
Yeah, it's bloody good in the shed.
But this thing on the water.
Yeah. 29 years of trying.
Come on, old girl, let's go.
Yeah.
Let's go.
That's awesome.
So, we've been working away at this project of building this floating school since 1993, and we've got a visitors book which has more than 400 people from all over the world who have worked on it, and I'm sorry to you all that it's not finished and doing its job yet. It's been a long mission. It was going to be a 6-year build. The idea is great. We had hoped by now that there'd be 60 of these around New Zealand alone, because they're very efficient, they sail really well, and they're traditional. Captain Cook met Waka here. They were doing 3 times his best speed, and they were carrying twice as many people as Captain Cook had on his boat, which wasn't a speedster, it was a freighter what he was sailing around in. So it's quite an historic vessel in the respect that it's the shape of the old seafaring double waka, and it is rope lashed, so it does move a wee bit on the water, makes it more comfortable. My good friend Malcolm, who's supported us for a long time with bits and pieces around our waka, has allowed me to store the 6 crossbeams and 2 deck cabins in this shed.
And because they're in there, his tractor's parked out in the weather.
Oh, no, that's nice.
However, that's the way Malcolm is. He has a big heart.
Oh,
so we're here to have a quick look at crossbeams, measure them up so we can have carvings made for the ends of them. I give love, I give thanks. I give grace, I give thanks. I give praise. Thank you. Crossbeams.
Wow. Nice.
These are beautiful. James Wharrem Designs. He's no fool. The plywood shape is in the centre. And then you've got these two triangular pieces, which are 3x2 timber cut long ways across the corners. So you get a shelf plus a beautiful adherence to the plywood, and then three layers top and bottom of 6x1 LOSP treated cowrie mediums from the sawmillers Lane and Sons in Totara North. And they said this is tantalised with unleaded petrol, so it doesn't change the colour of the timber. However, before you glue it, you need to give it a sand to freshen the surface, because salt comes out of it. And they said if you're dealing with cowrie, always use sharp sanding belts, sharp blades, because otherwise you blunten the grain of the cowrie, you close the grain and the glue won't stick. So it's quite amazing what you learn. The sawmillers knew so much, they passed on to me. Beautiful, 28 feet, tip to tip.
Yeah, nice job there, solid, eh?
Six of them.
Wow.
Yeah.
And the reasonably light for their strength.
Oh, yes,
yeah.
As light as you can get for that sort of strength.
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah, to Wharrem, James Wharrem's no fool. He studied the Polynesian vessels, you know, the old Polynesian vessels.
And how long are these?
They're 28 feet. So we're looking at just on 11 inches there, 6 inches that way.
11 by 6.
So the carving we're looking at putting on here, from this side, I clean up all of the surface, and the carving comes out. It come up probably an inch and a half up here.
Yeah.
Because the rope lash goes around here and attaches to the hull of the boat, you see?
Yeah.
So this is about the rope lashing not moving out.
Would the carvings come out on the sides as well?
Yes, they'd stick out here. At least an inch.
Yeah.
And at least an inch this side, and you can go down too.
Yeah.
So what they do effectively is you'd no way do you pull this boat in alongside a wharf or another boat, because the crossbeams stick out the side.
Yeah, yeah.
It's designed to nose up to the beach.
Yeah.
I'll write these measurements down.
Yeah, that's better be minimum.
I'll just write down the measurements of the beam.
I thought of the old cowrie coming out of the bottom of the mast on the old Echo. One of New Zealand's oldest sailing scows, I think she was, and I've got some pieces about that long.
Was one of them the one?
Yeah, one of them was the one I pulled in and picked in. Yeah,
right.
Yeah, some of New Zealand's oldest cowrie.
Oh, nice.
And it's beautiful. Yeah, I'm thinking that would just be perfect. I might take that down to the mill and get that milled into the right sizes,
right.
And use that for that.
So how far complete are you, Stoney?
We're 90% finished, going on the amount of glue. There's 1,000 litres of glue, and we've used 900 litres. So we're 90% there. There's the cost of the sails and the rigging and stuff like that, which on the pension now, Megan and I have put over 200,000 into it of our own money, people have contributed. Megan's mum bought the windows, the port lights. She paid for them.
incredible, and others have contributed. They are in the visitor's book. However, I'm getting slower, you know, and I don't like being up ladders in big concrete buildings anymore. So it's come to a halt in the last several years.
Two
almost completed deck cabins, yes. They go across the boat, support the masts, and they sit on these flats on top of two crossbeams, one either side. They're hopping, sit down, a couple, there's a double bunk in them. One of them is a helm position, which has a single bunk behind it. And I look at it and think, who the hell would want to sleep in there? And then I think, well, if I was shipwrecked and walking round the shore and I found this floated ashore, I'd be rather wrapped, because it is like an igloo, although it's more an egg because it doesn't have a loo. but it is a wooden igloo.
Yeah. Oh, this would be a mansion if you were shipwrecked, eh?
Exactly. That rope up onto the beach, you to get out of castle.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
That would make your day, wouldn't it?
Yes. And the boat can raise and lower its own mast as well.
Oh, true.
The bow walkway comes up. The forward mast can lower the aft mast, and then the bow walkway comes up and it lowers the forward mast. If you put them on the beach, you have to take the mast down.
That's awesome.
Because they'll blow away, they'll tumble away, they don't weigh anything.
Yeah, yeah.
Some of the Wharrems, they have a tent that goes up on the deck, you know, when they pull into harbour. When they pull into harbour, they've got small spaces inside the hulls, but they pull into harbour and they put up a tent and their kitchen goes outside and they live in the, you know.
Oh, true.
Yeah, lap of luxury in the nice weather.
Does that work here?
Fire pit in the middle of the deck, yeah. So pull a tent up with your lifting gear from your masts. You can hold a cover up over the whole hull, between both hulls.
Big marquee on the water, and the nice weather.
Sheltered centre deck.
Yeah.
It'd be awesome.
Yeah, lovely, wouldn't it?
They've got everything.
Yeah.
Yeah.
James
Wharrem of Cornwall designed it by copying the boats he saw in the museums in England and Europe. He copied them in plywood. So they don't lean, and they move a certain amount with the surface of the water. They're very easily driven, that's why the masts are only waterline length. You've got double bunked, double cabins at each end of each hull, and across the boat itself you've got double cabins as well, which are ideal for children. They're hop and sit down cabins. So you've got privacy, you've got ease of movement over the water, especially with the prow carvings and stern carvings to split the water so it doesn't fall on the foredeck. They're incredible. Barry Brailsford realised that there'd only been weapons in New Zealand for about 550 years, but there'd been people in New Zealand for at least 1500 years, and they had no weapons. I started looking for them when I was 11, because I found these tools. Well, these tools found me. And we'd already sold probably 30 stone tools from our land in the Pleurus Sounds. We were burning the fern, bracken fern, and native grasses, autumn safe pasture we called it. You burn it in the late summer and it grows again before winter. And we'd already sold 30, I believe, when Mariam got steel, they dropped their stone tools. But these were rolled out by a bulldozer. These were underground. They were way older than anything we'd found. And to have the brain power and the knowledge to put square edges on stone tools, they have to heat treat the stone. And this one is a totally different stone to that one. This is compressed ocean mud, and this I believe is argillite. And the craftsman who built them both has left the outside of the boulder on the non-working end, like a trademark. And these could have been built 1,500 years ago.
Yeah.
And there they were at my feet, you know, after the bulldozer had rolled them out. And I know now they were buried in 14s, and we only picked up two. We didn't look under the spill. There were possibly another 12 there.
They were buried in 14s.
Yeah, yeah, in various stages. They weren't all ready to use. This one's been shone, polished a bit. In time, they would be totally shiny. I always picture the stone toolmaker, tap, 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 tap. We found the stones that they used to tap them on our land, and we called them throwing stones. They'd been altered in shape, but they came from a big river somewhere a long way from our place. They were no natural stone like that. And I believe, well, I've found out since, because I started looking then at New Zealand's history at 11 years old, 1961. Those throwing stones were napping stones, that's why the little dents. But they also threw them to harvest birds. And I know now that they heated those stones in a fire and then pushed them inside the bird with the feathers still on, and pushed the bird's head up to seal it off, and they cooked while they were walking.
Started cooking.
They were cooking. The birds were cooking with the stones they'd used to harvest them, which they used to work the tools.
Oh, yeah.
So, you know, the very fact that these were rolled out by a bulldozer, and we spotted them, I spotted them. Yes, is the reason why we're building the Waka. We're not digging it out because it's a lot easier on trees to use plywood. Our tunnel house opened onto the public car park where the tourists park when they go on the journey across Lake Manapouri to Deep Cove, Doubtful Sound. And people could see through the wall of the tunnel house, of course. They could see this big Waka being built right there. So all sorts of people came in the door, and each of them was showing these tools. And then they walked the Waka and they signed a visitor's book, and some came back and helped or contributed. And we had this Maori fella, mysterious Maori fella, handsome man, dignified man. He came several times, and I said to Megan, we've had this mysterious Maori fella. He asks huge questions. And because Barry Brailsford had written Tattoo Land, Waitaha had written Song of Waitaha. And I heard about it, Megan heard about it early on, and we got one of the first copies printed. It actually had a misprint in it. We got one of the first copies. It's not in print anymore, it's like Song of Waitaha. We had it. And this mysterious Maori one day said, do you want to know more? And after Waitaha printed Song of Waitaha, then they invited selected people from the communities to teach their histories. Captain Cook met in New Zealand boats that did three times his best speed and carried twice as many people. The world's best rope, with our flax and our cabbage tree leaves. The cabbage tree leaves make longer lasting in salt water ropes than the flax does.
Hmm.
The flax let him build the best sails, the world's best sails. And there were the world's best trees to build boats out of, the kauri and the kahikatea. Plus all the small ones were for your masts and spars and crossbeams. They were all here. Paint and varnish came from here. Those Waka were painted and varnished.
Yeah.
With the kauri gum and
all things in
hot shark oil. Kauri gum melted in hot shark oil. And that's why the kauri gum rush went on with the colonising for paint and varnish.
Oh, yeah. Because it was the best.
Yeah. Well, they didn't have it until they met New Zealand's natives. Yeah,
it's a good place to have the all the marine gear, isn't it?
Oh,
Incredible.
What's needed most to kickstart this project, to get it out of the shed, or, you know, get it going? What's required?
I've just checked my lotto ticket today, and if I'd had a $200,000 win, I could then pay people to finish it and I'd be able to rig it. I'm pretty sure $200,000 would see people paid well to finish it, with me observing the quality and mixing the glue. I've mixed every mix of glue. It's crucial that it's done by someone who's on the ball. So yes, and it's already had a big improvement in people's lives, just the very fact of working on it, you know, of being there and looking at it even. Mm. You haven't got to be crazy to take on a project as big as that, but it helps. My darling wife, before she passed, said, whatever happens with the Waka, the journey's been worth it. The people it's brought us, the experiences we've had. But also, Megan believed that any decent husband either had a project or a mistress, and she'd be happy that I've got an unfinished project rather than an unfinished mistress. So I'm still working with Megan.